Dr. Filip Kovačević is joining us on this podcast. He's a geopolitical author, a university professor teaching at the University of San Francisco. He is also the chairman of the Movement for Neutrality for Montenegro, and he's also part of Sibel Edmonds' team at the Boiling Frog Post and their new initiative, which is Newsbud, for which they have a Kickstarter active at the moment. Welcome, Dr. Kovačević.
Thank you very much, Hrvoje. I'm glad to be back. First of all, I'd like to tell you about the great initiative that Sibel Edmonds has started together with her partners. It's called Newsbud, and it is going to be completely independent, nonpartisan media project.
And you've got an impressive team there with Pepe Escobar and a whole bunch of other folks. The Kickstarter is live. And can you tell us a bit more about what Newsbud will be and hopes to achieve?
Definitely. Newsbud has great ambitions. Newsbud wants to be a major media network, but run completely independently from the corporate sponsors. Newsbud will have no ads. Newsbud will be financed by the people like us, by ordinary people. It will be media of the people, by the people, and for the people. And this is why we have a very important Kickstarter campaign. We need to raise money in order to run this project. We need about $1 million in 2 months in order to have this service provided, not only for the citizens of the United States, but for all free people in the entire world. And this is why I urge your listeners, our listeners, to support us. They can pledge anything from the price of a bus ticket to the sponsorship of $10,000. And there is also an important corrective on our efforts. In other words, if we do not succeed to raise about $1 million in 2 months, all the money is going to be back, going to go back to the sponsors. In other words, it's all or nothing. So please help us. Help us to have this product out there, because this will be media with integrity, in contrast to so much media that's out there today, especially the mainstream media.
And I'm definitely going to be supporting that. I love supporting Kickstarters like this. And you know, if Boiling Frog's post will convert to Newsbud, or will it continue to exist, or...
Yes, Boiling Frog Post is going to become a component of Newsbud, but Newsbud is going to be much bigger. It will have daily headline news. It will have investigative reports. It will have so many podcasts, so many video reports from the reporters from all over the world. So it's an amazing product. And as you pointed out, it combines so many independent, talented people. Journalists, experts, producers, this is going to be big. So I urge your listeners to support us.
Okay, so don't forget the Kickstarter. I'll post the images. And let's talk now about the continuing theme that we've been discussing, NATO in Montenegro. What news do you have on that front?
Yeah, definitely. Our main theme on this podcast is the geopolitics of the Balkans. So looking at the Balkans in the year 2016, what we see is the further efforts of NATO to expand. In early December, NATO has invited Montenegro to become its 29th member state. However, this process is just beginning. It is far from certain, in my opinion, that Montenegro will in fact become a NATO member state. Why? Because the majority of the people in Montenegro are against that. They are against NATO membership. However, on the other side, we have the intense effort of the US NATO propaganda machine connected to the Montenegrin government, run by the very corrupt long-time leader Milo Djukanovic, who's basically a puppet of the US NATO empire, and who will do anything they want so that he can stay in power, so that he can rob his people of a few more millions of dollars and euros. So what we have is the fact that the NATO project in Montenegro is being supported by very corrupt people. And this is what the citizens of Montenegro recognize. And this is why they organize. This is why they demonstrate. And this is why they will not accept this decision to be made outside of a referendum. So people in Montenegro, the majority, and it's interesting, you know, according to the information that we have, that we gained, that our organization, the Movement for Neutrality of Montenegro, has gained from the insiders in the government, we know that they have run a public opinion poll, which they are hiding from the people, from the public, in which it said that even those people who support NATO membership want to have a referendum. In other words, 84% of those people who support NATO membership also want to have a referendum. So in other words, the vast majority of people want to have their say. People want to be asked. And this is what the referendum is for. However, the corrupt opportunist mafiocrats in power are against that because they're against the will of the people. All they want is to present themselves as the main NATO activists in Montenegro, as the people who help the US NATO empire swallow up another piece of territory. And I have to tell you that, as you of course know, that Montenegro is very strategically important. It has the Adriatic coast, about 120 kilometers of the coast, that so far has not been included into NATO. And so NATO is doing all it can to incorporate this territory. And so we have the basic conflict between the big military industrial structure on one hand, helped by corrupt politicians, and the people on the other side. And I think people will win.
And so you think it's currently at a stalemate between the pro-NATO and the Montenegrins that are demanding a referendum?
Oh, yes, definitely. What we have at the formal level is this process of ratification. In other words, this invitation has to be ratified by the parliaments of the member states. So we are talking about 28 member states, and of course the people in Montenegro, you know, who are being forced to join. In other words, if there is no referendum, this will be a forced decision on the part of the government, and the people will never accept it. So NATO has already lost a lot of its legitimacy because it paid for a very brutal and aggressive propaganda campaign full of lies and half truths, and now of course it will lose even more of its legitimacy because it will try to get the country without its people being asked about it. I have to say that as this process was unfolding, some countries within NATO expressed their disapproval of Montenegro's membership. Not long ago, about a year ago, the French president Hollande said that NATO will accept no more countries. In other words, what could happen is that this invitation to be stalled or stopped by the French parliament. Because I think Hollande is thinking about the balance of power in Europe. And for Montenegro to enter NATO would further destabilize the relationship between the European Union and Russia. So in other words, what we have is the popular revolt against NATO that is going to have some allies at the top, perhaps from the French President Hollande, and of course also from the from the Russian government and the Russian President Putin, because not having Montenegro in NATO is also part of the Russian geopolitical calculations. But I have to say that most people in Montenegro would want to have a militarily neutral country. In other words, a country that does not belong either to NATO or to the Russian military bloc. There is no support in Montenegro for the Russian military bloc.
And before we look at the latest piece that you've written, is there anything else interesting that we should know going on in the Balkans? There's a lot of news with the regarding the immigration, but is there anything on your radar?
Oh, yeah, definitely. You know, this is going to be a very politically significant year for the Balkans. There are elections in so many Balkan states, Serbia, Macedonia, Montenegro, perhaps even in Kosovo and Bosnia. So what we are having is essentially a lot of political propaganda going on, a lot of mobilization going on, and at the same time, this is coupled with the refugee crisis that shows no sign of becoming smaller. And in fact, the refugees are going into the Balkans through Greece at the rate of about 20,000 to 50,000 a month. But the expectations are that this number is going to increase as we go into the warmer weather. So what may happen in the Balkans is that you have this, the election season, you have the instability in the institutions that have never been strong or democratic to begin with. And then you have the added crisis of thousands of refugees that may also include some returning fighters from Syria. So what may happen is a lot of, number one, political instability, but also perhaps certain terrorist incidents. Because as we know, ISIS is slowly but surely losing its ground in Syria, and so many of the fighters are coming back to Europe, because we have to remember, most of them are citizens of European states, including NATO states. So we have to wonder, you know, about NATO, you know, allowing this, and how this could happen, that so many citizens of NATO states went to Syria, were undetected, and now are coming back and appear to be undetected again. And I also have to say that it's the places like Kosovo and parts of Bosnia that have provided havens, safe havens, for a lot of Islamist fanatical ideology and the people supporting those ideas.
And you mentioned 2016 would be a important year for the Balkans, and I think that's a good segue into the latest piece you wrote 2 weeks ago for the EU blog Active. And I found it very interesting, and I think there's some weight to your, well, a projection, a possibility. Will the next UN Secretary General come from the Balkans? And maybe you can tell us your thesis there.
Well, if you look at the United Nations, you'll see that it is divided by regions. And if you look at its history, you'll find out that there has never been a Secretary General coming from Eastern Europe. And so, in other words, the Eastern European group of countries will probably get a chance to choose one of their own for this position. Now the question is who this is going to be. And I looked at in this article that you talked about, that was initially published by Boiling Frog Post, I looked at different candidates and I evaluated their possibilities of success. I have to say that I started with Vuk Jeremic, who was the Serbian foreign minister some years ago, and I thought that symbolically speaking, he would have the greatest chance because he was already in a high UN position. In other words, he was the president of the General Assembly for 1 year. And he was successful in beating the candidate who was proposed by the United States and NATO. So in other words, Vuk Jeremić has a lot of support among the nations who are not in Europe, among non-European nations. Because to remind you, the voting is the majority voting in the General Assembly for its president. But this position lasts only for a year. So Vuk Jeremić was the president of the UN General Assembly for a year. Now we are talking about the UN Secretary General, which is a position that has a mandate of 5 years. And so he would have the greatest chance. However, he needs to be nominated for this position by his own government, the Serbian government. But he is a politician from the opposition. And so he is not going to get the support of the Serbian government and the Serbian president. We know that. So he does not have a chance to be nominated, even though his chances of getting chosen are great. This is paradoxical, the Serbs themselves are divided. Instead of helping one of their own to attain such an important position, they are divided among themselves. The next candidate I looked at is Irina Bokova. Irina Bokova, at this point of time, is the head of UNESCO, which is an important UN agency dealing with cultural heritage and educational programs. She's from Bulgaria, and she has been educated in Moscow. She graduated from the prestigious Moscow University of International Affairs, the famous GIMO. She had many positions in Bulgarian government, but she's also, after the end of the Cold War, she started to develop very close relationships with NATO and with the Washington establishment. So in other words, she would be the person who would satisfy both sides, the Russian side, and also the US-NATO side, because after all, she was trained in Russia, and yet she works closely with the United States. So she could be a sort of a double agent in a certain sense. And also, importantly, she's a woman. And never in history of the UN has there been a woman, the Secretary General. And this is a very important consideration, especially if Hillary Clinton, who's the only woman candidate for possible candidate for the U.S. presidency, does not get elected, and I think the chances are that she's not going to get elected. In other words, in my opinion, she is not even going to get a chance to become the Democratic candidate for the elections because of the affair with the emails. In my opinion, she's going to be forced out of the race by the FBI indictment. Because of so many revelations coming out of her emails, you know the story about her emails. So what I'm seeing is that especially if the next U.S. president is not a woman, this will be an added pressure on the UN for the next UN Secretary General to be a woman. So I would say that Irina Bokova has the greatest chance of getting elected. However, there is also another person, another candidate, who I would like to mention, and that's Danilo Turk. He is the former Slovenian president. He also had a high position in the UN before. He's a well-respected professor of international law. His presidential mandate in Slovenia was one without any major scandals. So he has the support of the Slovenian people and the Slovenian government. And most importantly, I think he has the support of the Chinese government. So the Chinese government may not want to support a candidate like Irina Bokova, who has ties to both Russia and the United States, but would instead like to support a candidate who's a legitimate candidate with education that's appropriate, with prestige that's appropriate, and who is also very friendly to the Chinese influence. In fact, Danilo Turk was in China not long ago, and he gave an interview on CCTV. And from this interview, one could see that he spoke about a fairness and justice in the world, and all the issues that the Chinese government at this point of time would support. To remind our listeners, the choice of the UN Secretary General has to be made, first of all, by the great powers who have the veto power in the Security Council. In other words, if one of them vetoes the candidate, then this candidate is out. And to remind your viewers and listeners, five countries have veto power: United States, France, UK, Russia, and China. And I think if you look at the configuration of their relations at this point of time, Danilo Turk can get more votes than Irina Bokova. So I would say that even though there's going to be a pressure on the UN to elect Irina Bokova, for many different reasons, as I mentioned, but also because she's a woman, I think in the end, Danilo Turk will get the nomination.
That's a very interesting, original, unique projection. And yes, I think, you know, there's a lot of weight to that. So we'll just have to see what happens. And any other last thought regarding the Balkans? A final comment?
Not at this time. I think the Balkans as a region is getting more and more important geopolitically. It's acquiring the significance it had 100 years ago, in the period right before World War I. And the reason for this is that in Europe, we have the new Cold War going full force. And I have to remind you that if you look at the old Cold War, more people have died during the old Cold War than during both World War I and World War II. I'm talking globally. So in other words, Cold War, it's a war, and this may lead to a lot of instability in the Balkans. And what we have to do as progressive individuals, as individuals committed to freedom and justice and individual rights, what we have to do, we have to work hard to uncover, to reveal the propaganda points coming out of the big powers apparatuses, big powers bureaucracy. We need to educate the people in the sense that they have to realize, especially in the Balkans, that they are all brothers and sisters. In other words, they have to realize that they should not fight for the sake of the confrontations of the great powers. The people of the Balkans have to say no to being playthings of the great powers. And this is why I talk frequently about the idea of the Balkan Federation. The Balkan Federation that would assure that the people of the Balkans and the states of the Balkans would have a strong voice and enough resources to resist becoming a plaything in the game between US NATO on one side and Russia and perhaps China on the other.
Okay. Dr. Filip Kovačević, of the chairman of the Movement for Neutrality of Montenegro, thank you very much for this episode.
Thank you very much, Hrvoje. And once again, please support Newsbud. Newsbud is so important for the sanity in the world today, for the fight for individual rights and justice.